For this last video on ice tables, we're going to work through these three problems. In the previous video, I had the wrong example for number three. The correct version is in your PowerPoint slide, so we're going to work this version. If you need to, pause the video here to make sure you have the right setup and the right equation. For our first example, the variation here is that we're working with an acid, acetic acid, dissociating in water. Remember that liquids and solids have constant concentrations. And so anytime we have a pure liquid or a pure solid in a chemical equation, we don't need to calculate how much it changes by because they're constant. Remember that we also don't include solids and liquids in our expression. So when we go to write our Kc expression, we wouldn't include water down here in the denominator. All of the other steps remain the same though. Equation, ice table, expression, math equation, and then solve for x. The easiest way in this one is to assume that x is going to be about zero because we have a small k value, and so that x can go away in the denominator. So this becomes your setup with that closed parentheses here so that we take the square root of the product of these two numbers to get our x value. Since we made the assumption, we want to check our assumption that x is valid. That is less than 5%, so this is good. And that gives us our x value. Remember, our last step, of course, would be subtraction for our reactant. So we're going by decimal places. For our products, we're going by sig figs, where x would be rounded to 2 sig figs, which is how we get these final answers. For our second problem, the variation here is that we're given quantities of all three substances. And so the variation is that we actually need to calculate a Q value first. So we set up our equilibrium expression. Products over reactants, coefficients are the exponents, and we plug in all of our quantities. Noticing that, of course, our hydrogen and iodine are given the same value, so we can just square those. And this gives us a Q value of 806. Really, we just want it for relative purposes. So if we misrounded, not the end of the world, but we do see that Q is larger than K. That means that Q needs to decrease. That means products decrease while reactants increase. In other words, this reaction is going in the reverse direction. And so on this slide that's in your notes, we have all of that information and a good time to point out relevant examples in the textbook in OpenStax 5 through 10, working through extra ice tables. So we decided this reaction needs to go in the reverse direction. Again, that means products decrease while reactants increase. We set up our expression, we plug in our equilibrium values, and recognize the easiest way to solve this one is perfect squares. So we have quite a few math steps to go through. Pardon me. Quite a few steps to go through to solve for x. But once we do, we get this unrounded value. If x was going to be our final answer, we would go to 3 sig figs because of k and our initial concentrations. However, realize in each quantity, our last step is addition and subtraction, so we are limited to decimal places. And so we will have 4 decimal places for the reactants, and we will have 2 decimal places for our product. For our next example, this is similar to one we've already worked, where we are given initial quantities of reactants. Notice, of course, they are in moles, so we need to divide by the volume to get in molarity. This is the problem that at the end of the previous video, I had the wrong problem up, so make sure you're working with the correct one. Similar idea for the two problems if you want to work both, by the way. We're not told anything about the products here, so we can only assume zero. The difference in this problem is that we're told how much of our H2S we have at equilibrium. And so that means in our fourth line, our second equilibrium line, we know how much is left over. So of course, this reaction has to go forward. So reactants decrease, products increase, paying attention to our coefficients here. And when we set everything up in our ICE table, we have something that looks like this. So again, we know our final value for the H2S. That means that we can set our equations of equilibrium equal to each other, right? Both of these lines are representing the same thing. And so that gives us a way to solve for X. When we solve for X, we realize that it is 0.25 molar, and that means we can literally plug it into each one of these quantities to get our final values. So again, we still need an equilibrium expression to solve this problem. Now we can plug in our equilibrium values and get our equilibrium constant. And so this slide shows all of the equilibrium concentrations and our equilibrium constant. And this last slide is not a common one that we work, not a common type of problem, but it is helpful to point out that not all equations are going to end up as a second order polynomial. Notice in this equation that we do potentially get a square on the bottom here, but we don't have one on the top. And so when we go to solve, the math is considerably easier on this one. So same steps, I'll still encourage you to work through this one to try to solve it, but much more straightforward than the other problems that we have solved. And that concludes our equilibrium chapter.